So these are the polyunsaturated fats. So polyunsaturated fats have two legs for us, omega-6s and omega-3s. And we're going to talk about the polyunsaturated fats in terms of grains and what we eat. Let me go to the next one. We have omega-6s and omega-3s. What's the difference between the two of them? They're both polyunsaturated fats. I mean, there's a different molecular composition, okay? Slightly different, just slightly different. But that difference is a potentially big deal. Omega-6s come from grains. Omega-6s are a storage fat for plants to have enough on hand so it can be converted to the omega-3s. When you get most of your polyunsaturated fats from seeds, you're getting much, much more omega-6s. When you eat plants, you get much more omega-3s. Because only plants have the ability to convert omega-6s into omega-3s. They're both essential fatty acids. What do I mean by both essential fatty acids? When they say essential, they mean we can't make them. So we have to get them outside. I mean, if you could make a vitamin, they wouldn't be called a vitamin. So vitamins, are in fact something you have to take from the outside. Same thing for this. So we need them. And they come from plants. They come from seeds and grains, and there's oils and animals that eat these foods. Well, now let's see. What animals do we eat that eat a lot of it? Cattle. It is not a natural act for a cow to eat large amounts of grain. Now, there may be something hanging out in the field, but that's small potatoes. In the nature, they eat grass. We give them grain. Why? Why do we give them grain? To make them fat. And they develop lots of saturated fat and lots of omega-6s. Omega-6s are more inflammatory. It's still very much more healthful than eating saturated fat. But this is that controversy, this is that issue, that omega-6s are inherently more inflammatory. They come from storage grains. If the animal ate plants, they'd have a lot more omega-3. These are, in certain ways, pro-drugs. Your body has to have them as a basis for what it needs to do, but it converts them into a more active ingredient. Some of this can be that way. This has to be converted to an active form when we eat it. Or we can eat fish that already did the work for us. That's why we take fish oil. They have to convert this into an active form. We do too. Here's flaxseed and canola and soybean oils. This is what comes in. If I was to ask you, what is the most abundant fat in the world, what would you say? It's omega-3s. And you go, how could it be omega-3s? They're like, how can it be omega-3s? We've got all these fat cows. We've got all the grains. It turns out omega-3s, as it does for plants, it does for us, is needed in the chloroplasts of the plants that for photosynthesis. So every membrane that the chloroplast has, every cell wall, has to have the omega-3 fatty acid in its cell membrane. Remember we talked about the fats? If they don't have that, that sunlight can't make the magic and make glucose. So every plant has to have it. So it's a little bit, lots of it, and when you're a cow and you eat a lot of plant life, you get a lot of omega-3s. That's the connection. Omega-6s were recognized in the 1960s, okay? Omega-3s weren't recognized as essential until the 1980s. I was a grown-up. They didn't know that at that time. Talk about the evolution of nutrition. I'm curious to know what else will be found out that isn't obvious to us now. So we only knew about it then. We don't like, if you're an industry person and you're making a commodity, omega-3s are not good. They're very fragile to get oxidized. Their bonds, the oxygen, it destroys them, it changes them. Omega-6s, because they're storage, are more resilient. and they store better. That's why plants store their fats as omega-6s, because it's hardier. And then they use it to help for germination. You know, after the baby plant is born, then they use the omega-3s for the plant. So let's delve a little deeper into these omega-6s and omega-3s. We need both omega-6s and omega-3s, and they compete when we eat them for the same enzyme system to convert them into their active forms. Now in nature, or in plants, or the ideal, that might be 2.3 or 1:1. And this actually has more of a propensity to use the enzyme system than this, because this is very important, and this is a little more common in the grains. What's happened is, instead of this being a 1:1 ratio, or 1:1 relationship, or 2:1, so that these can compete with this to become active. The omega-3s are not active. They have to be converted into something that's active. And what is active is EPA and DHA, or what we call from the fish oils. They're the finished product. And that's what goes to the cell membrane, and that's what gives us benefit. We don't put omega-3s into our cell membrane unless it's the finished product. So they can compete at 2 or 3 of these to this. They can't compete when this is 10, 20, or 30 to 1. It overwhelms them. And so when you eat flaxseed, anybody eat flaxseed here? Okay, do you grind up the flaxseed fresh? Great. And the reason is because if you don't, the flaxseed goes bad. You know what bad flaxseed is? Linseed oil, you know, the kind of stuff that stinks. Interesting. Something that's so valuable becomes something so repugnant that you take off paint with. And when you eat flaxseed oil, or flaxseed oil, you're eating omega-3s that have to be converted. In addition, that the flaxseed also has omega-6s. And you don't need more omega-6s. We get huge amounts of omega-6s. So I think it's healthy to eat flaxseed, because I think it has other things, lignans, and it's got other benefits. But I would say if you're going to be taking flaxseed or flaxseed oil for the omega-3 properties, get something with a finished product in it. Because this can only compete to maybe 5%. So if you eat this with the normal diet that we normally have, if you eat flaxseed, the conversion of omega-3s to its final product is only 5%. You'd have to eat huge amounts, and we don't, and we can't. And then you'd gain weight. It's too much fat. So what does the omega-3s do? Omega-3s are fleet and flexible. Why do fish have a lot of omega-3s, EPA and DHA, the finished product? Why? They're in water. They have to be flexible. They have to be quick and flexible. And that's what it's designed for. That's why DHA in your eye, it's fast. Your brain uses it fast. So this is very important stuff. You know, infants need arachidonic acid, which comes from this, newborns. And they need that. And they need DHA, which is one of the pieces of the omega-3 when it's in final product. They need that. It's absolutely essential. And just for those physicians that may be out there, how it works in part is it's a membrane stabilizer. It affects calcium influx, and so it stabilizes things, which may be one of the benefits of why it's an antiarrhythmic. It has anti-inflammatory or less inflammatory properties than the omega-6s. Temperature of the medium in which an animal exists has a direct correlation with the composition of animal fatty tissue. Fatty acids in slow, large animals are more saturated than the fatty acids of fast, small animals, which contain more DHA. And the brains of all the brain studies that I've read have high amounts of DHA. And it is thought that, you know, modern man developed in Africa, and they first thought it was on the savanna, but there's some suggestion that it may have been formed on the coast, where they had more access to EPA and DHA. So when there was a mutation that enabled their brain to grow, they had the nutrition that they needed to have to make that happen. This is interesting. Leaky fluid membranes allow all of a cell's reactions to take place faster, including nerve impulses, signal reception, and muscle contractions. Remember we talked about Meade's acid? We make that if we can't get enough essential fatty acids, if you're unlucky enough. And there are studies about the EPA and DHA in for people who have mental illness. They did it with kids in England where mothers that didn't eat fish, which was worse, eating fish with the potential of mercury, which is more theoretical than actual, or not getting enough EPA and DHA. And they showed those that had more EPA and DHA, the finished product of omega-3s, did better. They had higher IQs, they did better in school, they had less social issues. So these things are not academic, unimportant things. They affect how you live, they affect your brain, they affect how you feel. We just don't pay enough attention to it. Omega-6 are inflammatory. They make arachidonic acid. You need them. You have to have them. Who's going to fight that fight when the fungus or the virus or the bacteria attacks your one-year-old? You need them. You need them both. They're essential. But we've made one hugely more than the other, and that's the problem. They're not put into a proportion that is healthy. This just gives you an idea of what things look like. Remember, I said we have to have a combination of polyunsaturated, fats as part of that lipid membrane and saturated fats. 50% of the time it's saturated fat, but there are, like in the brain, doesn't have to have saturated fat. It has to move very quickly. The speed at which DHA, which is a polyunsaturated fat, moves, the configurations that it takes, makes the membrane leaky. It's moving, like I've heard millions of times a second. And it moves around in order for it to be able to effectively communicate information to the cell and have the cell send out signals. Now, in a nerve cell, we know what that means, and it has to be really fast. So it leaks, and when it leaks, there's more potential that you have to have a higher metabolic rate. And when you have a higher metabolic rate to pump that stuff back and forth, it's like a hydroelectric plant, you get free radical production, and you get more damage. That speed is why your brain takes 20 to 25% of the energy that we have, goes to the brain, which is what, 2 or 3% of the body weight? Just a tiny piece uses almost a quarter of our energy to supply that speed, and the DHA and all that, and the cell membrane, it's all part of that. If you eat crap, if you don't eat those things, then it starves the brain. The brain will make do, but it isn't running optimally. And I guess we're talking today about optimal health. This is an animation of how when you eat polyunsaturated fats, omega-6s, omega-3s, and other fats, you got the trans fats, you even got how these go to the cell membrane. It's in the bloodstream. La, 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 la. Oh, I need some stuff. I go there. What you eat goes to the cell membrane, and one of the enzymes or the chemicals that determine what goes to the membrane is not able to distinguish between omega-6s or omega-3s or Meade's acid. Whatever passes by, it grabs it. So it isn't sophisticated enough to say, I need some DHA. It just picks what's there. So the more you eat of one, that's what it has. So it goes to the cell membrane. It gets converted, it gets changed, you get arachidonic acid, you have EPA and DHA now in the cell membrane. There it is, all smiley. And then you have the nucleus and this. Now, this is a cell membrane with those phospholipids, okay? This is an intruder. This is somebody knocking at your house at 3 o'clock in the morning. No, they're opening up the window. And Rover says, my God, we're under attack. And it sends signals to here. It's called nuclear factor kappa B, just a name. It's a fundamental, basic, major player in the inflammatory response. And so the membrane, which has these, sends information to here through a protein. It cleaves a protein, and then this goes into the nucleus. This then tells the nucleus to make chemicals that go out and kills the intruder. That's the inflammatory response. We have the delta force, but it has to be activated in the genes. It's activated by nuclear factor kappa B. And guess what motivates nuclear factor kappa B? The arachidonic acid, the omega-6s, or omega-3s. Omega-3s send less of a response. They have a feedback that actually can shut the nuclear factor kappa B off or down. And so it calms the waters. If you don't have that and you are completely omega-6s, then you may miss that. The issue is, does it matter how much omega-6s you eat? But as you can see, that the omega-6s compete with the omega-3s, and so if you're eating stuff that has just omega-3s, it's not the finished product, you can't convert it into its active form.